Assalamu alaikum and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm your host this evening, Brother Jamil Muhammad, and this is a live call-in show. So if you'd like to participate, please join us by calling 773-434-6625. And joining me in this first segment, we have a great brother and guest and friend of the show, Brother John Rogers. Assalamu alaikum. Good evening. How are you?
I'm okay.
Good, 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 good. Brother, I know that we were talking briefly off air, but I'm sorry. Go ahead. I'm sorry. First of all, tell our viewing audience who you are and what you do.
Oh, well, you know, I'm John Rogers. You know, 36 years ago, I founded Ariel Investments.
Yes, sir.
And we manage stock portfolios for institutions like corporate pension funds,
right?
Public pension funds. Endowments, yes. And then we have mutual funds for individual investors. So right. If someone's got a 529 program in the state of Illinois, they can add our mutual funds easily. Right. If they've got a financial advisor, they can ask their advisor to use Ariel funds.
Yes.
And we've been focusing on mostly small and mid-cap value stocks here in Chicago.
Right.
And we do international investing in New York.
Right.
So that's kind of our business. Melody Hobson, our co-CEO, has been with us 28 years.
Yes, sir.
And we got about another 100 people or so who help us run and grow the business.
Yes, sir.
So I've been lucky.
Well, been lucky. You're very engaged in the community as well, and an expert on these things. And, you know, having the opportunity to sit down here with you and looking at, let's say, the state, the financial state of a lot of people right now, and I think we were alluding to the financial divide seems to be growing in this country, particularly when you look at the minority community versus the white community. We look at the middle class, which seems what it was 20 years ago. It isn't, you know, right now. And so could you talk in terms of some of the things that have led to this financial gap or divide?
Sure. And you know, I think the first thing I would say, though, is, you know, things have gotten worse and worse for us in our community.
Right.
We use this data from the Federal Reserve Board of St. Louis. A guy named Ray Bashar has done the research that shows between 1992 and roughly 2016, African Americans, college educated African Americans saw their wealth decline 10%, while college educated whites saw their wealth increase over 90%.
Wow.
So that's a huge gap in wealth over that almost 25 year period.
Yeah.
And there's you know, lots and lots of other data out there, but the bottom line is we've slowly but surely been going backwards. You know, after Harold Washington's death, and then, you know, the unfortunate untimely death of Maynard Jackson and some of our big city mayors, I think that's part of the problem.
Right.
We used to have these dynamic leaders, you know, Coleman Young in Detroit, Tom Bradley in L.A., people who are there fighting for us and making sure that we were getting equal economic opportunity in our communities. As the years have gone on, we've lost that kind of dynamic leadership that understood that the majority institutions needed to hire black and brown folks and let us be partners and managing directors and leaders in those organizations.
Right.
And they had to do business with black business.
Mm-hmm.
Because we always understood that if you had strong black businesses in our communities, we would employ each other.
Right.
We'd create our own philanthropy.
Right.
We'd support our own churches.
Yes.
We'd be role models for next generation leaders.
Yes.
And you know, we've really lost almost all of that, as we know. It's just really... It's really heartbreaking.
It's heartbreaking. You know, when I listen to you, you know, I know that most major cities and companies, they have their diversity goals as far as who they're supposed to give contracts to and things like that. So as far as the diversity spin that most major cities might have with their contracts, why hasn't that had the impact that we hoped that it would?
I think the major problem is the economy's evolved a lot.
Okay.
And we all know instinctively, if you think about it, our economy's become more of a technology-based economy and a professional services and a financial services company type of economy.
Mm-hmm.
So if you know, you think about it, the biggest companies in the world are companies like Facebook and Apple and technology. The big banks like Bank of America, JP Morgan Chase, consulting firms like Deloitte, Ernst & Young, those are the places now where the wealth and jobs are being created.
Yes, sir.
You know, venture capital, private equity. And so we've been allowed and continue to, maybe we'll get the important construction contract, which is important to our community, important to get the catering contract. But we also need to get the contracts and technology and professional services and financial services, because that's where the wealth and jobs and power and influence are in today's society. Right. If you think about it, our governor is a venture capitalist. Mm-hmm. Our prior governor, Bruce Rauner, was in private equity.
Yes.
Our mayor, former mayor Rahm Emanuel, was a investment banker.
Right.
Our current mayor now was a lawyer.
Yeah.
You know, all of them in professional services.
Right.
And so the problem now is if we don't, not only do we not get the wealth because we're not allowed to participate in that part of our economy, we're missing out on the political empowerment that we really deserve.
That's a good point. I think you've already generated a caller, so we're going to go to the line. Caller, are you there?
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Jamil. It's Sister Nora Muhammad calling from Camden, New Jersey.
Wa alaikum salam, sister.
It is great to see you, and I'm enjoying the conversation. Mm-hmm. And I have a question for the guest regarding wealth and the black community. You just talked about empowering ourselves. So what are we not doing with our money that is not creating or catalyzing generational wealth?
Well, I think a couple of things. You know, one of the things I tell people is, you know, we work in all of us, you know, a lot of us in our communities work in large banks, large insurance companies, large corporations that buy lots and lots of services.
Right.
And when we think about, for example, here in Chicago, we lost Johnson Publishing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Ebony and Jet Magazine, you know, that iconic building, the Johnson Publishing building, is no longer ours.
Right.
But it was because a lot of us were sitting in corporate America and not buying advertising in those publications.
Mm-hmm.
We were buying advertising in the white publications,
mm-hmm.
but not thinking about forcing the institutions that we work for to live up to the values that they say they care about. Because all these corporations say they care about diversity and inclusion,
mm-hmm.
but when you actually look back, peel back the onion and see where they're spending their money,
mm-hmm.
they're not spending it with our companies. They're not spending it in our communities.
Mm-hmm.
And often we sit in those corporate suites. So we sit on the board of directors of those institutions,
mm-hmm.
and we let it happen. And we know the white leadership's not going to on their own all of a sudden decide to start to work with our companies
mm-hmm.
and respect what John Johnson built with Ebony and Jet and other companies like that.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to make sure that those of us that have positions of influence are fighting for us when we have the opportunity to fight for us. I think that is critically, critically important.
Right. And you're absolutely right. We have to, if we're in a position to be an advocate and make a difference, we have to do that. Let me ask you, a lot of times I hear, especially from our African-American, our black businesses out here, that I just need that chance. How do I position myself? Many times the contracts that are out there might be too large in scope for a smaller company to benefit from. So, is there any advice? How can some of the maybe smaller black companies partner to take on a larger project?
I think that's an issue in our community. We should be finding ways to merge
mm-hmm.
and build bigger, stronger businesses that can mm-hmm. then go out and have, there be no excuses from some of these large places not working with us.
Mm-hmm.
But I think in some ways, we've been reluctant to partner with each other.
Yeah.
You know, it's interesting, in my field, as a money, you know, we were the first African-American money management firm when we started in 1983.
Okay.
And as the years have gone on, mm-hmm. a lot of companies have come and gone.
Mm-hmm.
Companies have done well for a while, and then they collapse. And we've never gotten a phone call from any of them to say, let's merge
right.
before it's too late.
Right.
And make both of our companies stronger so we can
yeah.
deal with the financial pressures in this industry and the ups and downs right. in the economy.
Right.
So I think you're right. We need to be able to get bigger.
Mm-hmm.
We also need to make sure that we have more enlightened customers that will work with us as we get bigger.
Yes.
You know, and I think there's some companies who do it really well. You know, McDonald's has always done it well. You know, there are over, I think, close to 300 African-American-owned McDonald's franchises.
Right.
You know, those guys are doing well. There's great suppliers doing everything from croutons to logistics.
Right.
You know, run by Baldwin Richardson Ice Cream, you know, run by mm-hmm. Eric Johnson,
right.
George Johnson's son.
Right.
There's Thompson, Mike Thompson, who has a sausage business that Frank Brooks used to have.
Okay.
You know, and Dave Durison used to have. They built big businesses because McDonald's was willing to work with them
mm-hmm.
and insist that the majority owners that owned the companies originally sold those companies to a minority-owned business.
Right.
So the reason I always bring that up is you got to get important customers to believe in black businesses early.
Right.
Give us the big contracts, and then we can finance those contracts. We can grow our businesses, build the scale we need to be successful. Mm-hmm. But if people don't give you a chance,
right,
you can never build something of scale.
How can we increase the accountability of some of these major corporations to do just that, to give some of the black corporations or smaller businesses a chance in order to kind of leverage that? I mean, I know that we alluded to earlier, just the data as far as diverse spend does not always tell the true picture.
Right.
You know, it's good for a soundbite, it's good to read out, but it's not having the impact. So what kind of pressures or accountability or things that should we be doing to raise more awareness around this?
I think we have to, on the one hand, celebrate the companies that are doing a great job.
Yes.
You know,
okay.
I mentioned McDonald's earlier. There are companies like Exelon, mm-hmm. you know, Northern Trust here in town, who are committed to doing things the right way. Mm-hmm. What we've got to do is, on the other hand, is stop celebrating the companies that are not doing a good job.
Yeah.
Too often we're given honors and giving them awards at our dinners and our conventions to companies mm-hmm. that are not living the values that are healthy for our community.
Mm-hmm.
But they write a check to that nonprofit,
right.
they get honored, and people sort of think they're doing okay when they really are not. So we got to stop honoring the people who are, I think, are playing a charades game.
Yes.
Pretending they care about us, but they really don't, and they get away with a small check, which mm-hmm. we think is unacceptable.
Mm-hmm.
I think the other thing we've got to do, of course, is I brought this up. I was speaking last week at the NAACP convention in Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
We have to support our progressive political leaders,
mm-hmm.
and we have to support our political community leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just so important. Whatever your values are, if you're a progressive, you know, we got to be there supporting these local institutions,
right.
because we know the difference. When Reverend Jackson took the Black Enterprise data, it showed that Silicon Valley didn't have any African Americans
right.
on any of their boards, pretty
right.
much,
right.
almost without exception.
Right.
He was able to go and single-handedly push Apple to have their first African American director, Hewlett Packard to have their first African American director. As you go down the list, he made a difference with that Black Enterprise data.
Right.
If we don't support institutions like Rainbow,
right.
we're not going to get that kind of progress.
Mm-hmm.
I've been talking to Reverend Sharpton a lot recently about how the museums in New York City, similar to the museums in Chicago, very few of them work with black businesses.
Right.
The foundations and the universities
right.
don't work with minority businesses in New York, NYU, Columbia,
right.
et cetera.
Right.
And so I've said, Reverend Sharpton, if you were to take your members and go out in front of the museums
mm-hmm.
and put a picket line around
right.
them,
right.
they would all of a sudden change their tune and start to work with black businesses.
Mm-hmm.
So a long way of saying, we've got to support our civil rights organizations so they have the resources to get in front and put the pressure on these institutions to do the right thing.
Right.
And so it's kind of up to us again.
Right. And you're right. And I want to, you know, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us to pool our resources. And, you know, in essence, created a nation within a nation, even with that example of whether newspaper, printing bank, the banks, the restaurants, things like that. But I want to go to the pool and the resources, and going back to what you said about Reverend Jackson in particular, it seems like today people make mockery or don't respect the ability to put pressure on corporations like we used to.
Right.
And so it's almost when that's talked about, many of our people aren't in this gauge and thinks that some of those methods aren't effective. But we've seen, as you said, a steady decline
right.
in the divide. And so what's wrong? Why do you think people have such apathy towards putting pressure on some of these larger corporations?
I think the apathy, you know, I think some of the people are just worn down.
Yeah.
You know, they've been fighting, you know, Reverend Jackson's been at it over 50 years.
Yes.
And I think some folks just gotten tired.
Yeah.
And they don't think that you can really make the difference. And so people stop coming to push on Saturday morning, stop supporting some of the conventions and the conferences and the Wall Street Project. You know, people have to show up. They've got to write the checks. And I think that they've just gotten tired.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, we don't celebrate the successes as effectively as we should. Like the
yeah.
example I gave of Silicon Valley.
Yeah.
It is factual that Hewlett Packard has four African Americans on they split into two companies, two blacks on each board.
Yeah.
Okay. You know, James Bell from Chicago was on the Apple board. That's just factual, and it didn't happen until Reverend Jackson showed up at those annual meetings. Mm-hmm. And so we got to make sure that people see how down the road, when now Apple's more progressive or more open, or Hewlett Packard's more progressive or more open, it's because of the work that we all did together. Right. And maybe our kids or our grandkids will have opportunities because we fought for each other. But I think people don't see the connection as well as they used to. Yeah. If they volunteer and they write the checks and they support our leaders, this will ultimately have enormous benefit for our community and our extended family, and again, our kids and our grandkids and multi-generational opportunities.
Right. Thank you for that. I think we have a call. Caller, are you there? Hello, caller.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Yes, sir. This is Sister Marta. Also, greetings to you, Mr. Rogers.
Greetings.
My question is in regards to, I have one in regards to your school, the status of Ariel Capital School. How is it faring in the charter school system, as well as are you still teaching financial literacy at that school? And if a person has a dream or an idea and don't have the funding, is there some way they can come through your organization and possibly talk to a financial planner? Thank you.
Well, thank you. On the first issue, the Ariel Community Academy is now about 22 years old, over 500 students, and we are still teaching financial literacy in the school. We're still giving kids real money to invest in real stocks. And just this week, we had a big event for alumni of the Ariel Community Academy. And we all went to Taste 222, which is Don and Liz Thompson's place, you know, downtown. And, you know, Don being the former CEO of McDonald's, you know, African-American icon, he spent about an hour and a half with the young people talking about his new business venture, and answering all kinds of questions about how to be a successful restaurateur and build a restaurant or get capital to raise to build a restaurant concept. Yes. And he talked about all of his great success, and his wife Liz was there. So it was just one of those great afternoons, and it was great to see the alums.
Yes,
you know, the Ariel Community Academy. So it's just doing well, and the kids are a lot of them are really flourishing.
Right.
You know, just doing really. A lot of the graduates are doing really well in their careers. So, and I know your father was very nice of having some of the kids come on the show.
Yes, sir.
And a couple of those guys are doing really, really well. You know, one works at Ariel full time, and so that's been really nice. When it comes to financial advice for individuals, we advise people if they're interested in investing in our Ariel Mutual Fund family, which is again focused on small and mid-cap value stocks in Chicago and international New York. If they need broader services, once we get a chance to hear about someone's needs, then we will refer them to a financial advisor that has a more broader set of products that they can work with the customer on. And hopefully they'll use our Ariel funds along with the other products that they show a customer.
Let me ask you this, because the college you referenced, the school, and you're involved in so much. What are some of the greatest influences on you that impacted you to want to give back and work so vigorously for the community?
I think a couple of things. You know, my father, is a well-known story, started buying me stocks when I was, 12 years old,
yes,
instead of toys, and for at birthdays or at Christmas time, and that was a wonderful blessing to get exposed to the markets on those holidays every year, and so we try to replicate that at the Ariel Community Academy, which is a public school, so kids get to invest, real dollars in real stocks the same way that I did as a kid. So I have to say my dad's influence was really, really important. He felt that African Americans needed to be exposed to the stock market at an early age and get comfortable in the markets at an early age. I think the other part of the community side to your question, I mention this a lot. John Johnson and George Johnson were great role models for me. And I particularly, I was fortunate to get to know both of them. And George Johnson, as I got to know his career over the years, I just was so extraordinarily moved by the way that he not only built Johnson Products and AfroSheen and UltraSheen into great brands, took his company public, the first African-American company to be on a public, American stock exchange, But then, you know, he, in his free time, created Independence Bank that became the largest black bank in the country. Mm-hmm. He started Soul Train. Mm-hmm. He used black advertising agencies like Burrell.
Right.
You know, he advertised in Ebony and Essence.
Right.
He was supporting our community broadly, and his ecosystem was extraordinary. You know, he would use black law firms, black accounting firms. And then also George Johnson, when the Urban League would have their dinners every year, the Golden Fellowship dinner, he'd be responsible for 70 tables.
Right. Okay.
And then finally, when Dr. King came to Chicago, desperate to make payroll in the midst of the Civil Rights Movement, George Johnson not only wrote checks personally to Dr. King, but he arranged for all the other black entrepreneurs to come together.
Right.
To give them those desperately needed checks at a really important time in the Civil Rights Movement.
Mm-hmm.
So when you're around people like John Johnson and George Johnson, you sit there and say, these people sacrificed so much to get doors open for all of us,
mm-hmm.
that you want to try and lead in the same way as you build your business in the next generation.
Right.
And the impact they've had, it's just been extraordinary.
You know, I can see that, and I know that. And living in a city like Chicago, we've had so many wonderful examples, you know, of success stories that at one time were celebrated, but many of our people now either don't remember or they're not celebrated as much. And so we have to kind of maybe look at the blueprint or success stories from the past. And one thing that comes to mind is many people may not feel that they have enough money to invest, or some of the hardest things is just fear.
Right.
And so how or what would you say to encourage people, or how do they start to build up to what they think is enough money to invest? Because when you talk about the stock market, I remember when I was introduced, it was in eighth grade. It was a whole class project. I remember the stock was Beatrice Foods, and it wasn't real money, but it really taught you about the long-term mm-hmm. kind of ebb and flows of the stock market and how to, you know, I remember we used to go to the stock, look at it, and made me aware of all the things that Beatrice was involved in. And so just that level of engagement, I don't know if they still do that in schools. I know, of course, you're doing it at Ariel School. However, that example of knowledge or desire, how do we instill that in our people to take the chance on things?
Well, there's a couple things there. You know, during President Obama's administration, I was fortunate to get to chair his council on financial capability for young Americans.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea was, how do we get young Americans financially literate and prepared for all the challenges they face as adults? And one of the recommendations we gave to President Obama is that we got to get the major financial institutions in urban cities to partner with urban public schools.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to not only teach the kids the things they need to know about the stock market
mm-hmm.
and the long-term benefits of investing, but also see role models that look like them.
Mm-hmm.
So they can think about financial services careers
yes.
and take the right courses in high school and college, so they're prepared to be able to be successful as financial executives down the road. And we just don't think there's enough of that, of these financial institutions partnering with urban public schools. And I think that would make such a difference for all of us if we could find a way to inspire and encourage that to happen. The other part of your question, for us, we at Ariel, we've tried to always have very modest minimums
mm-hmm.
to encourage people to get started.
Mm-hmm.
So it's you know, $100 a month or $1,000 to open up an account.
Mm-hmm.
We think it's just so important just to get started into the markets.
Right.
We've been able to show now, we have a almost 36-year track record, and our Ariel fund, our flagship fund, 33 years old.
Okay.
We've been able to compound money over 11% a year for that 33-year period.
Mm-hmm.
If someone had given us $1,000 in 1986, it would be worth over $30,000 today.
Right. Yeah.
So we really think you've got to get people, have to get their foot in the door,
mm-hmm.
get started investing, and then as you start to see the magic of the money compounding over time,
yes.
then that incentivizes you to save even more.
Yes.
And put more money away.
Yeah.
And so we think that's important. And then the final thing is, if you're going to invest outside of mutual funds, and pick your own stocks,
mm-hmm.
invest in companies you really understand that you can own for the long term.
Right.
You know,
right.
The greatest investor of all, Warren Buffett, always talks about invest in your circle of competence
mm-hmm.
and invest as if you can only make a few investment choices in your entire life.
Yes.
You know, and you find those good investments and stick with them.
Yeah, and that's what I would find, that people who invest, a lot of them, were looking at things too short term or didn't have the discipline to let things kind of play out. And,
exactly.
You know, you get a little anxiety and then you kind of hurt yourself by pulling out. You know,
that's the worst. That's it. That's worse.
I think we have one more caller. I know we're limited for time. Caller, you on the air?
Hey, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
This is Brother Emmanuel Omar, and I would like to ask Brother Rogers, can he talk something about his product that he have on the basketball court? I really enjoyed myself out there at the Wintrust Arena watching Sky Basketball. I'm a big fan of ladies basketball, and had the family out there on Comet Day, and it was a good time to have by all. And I would like to know if he can talk a little bit about sports, the team, and his relationship with Nike, if he haven't talked about it already, or just jumped on. Yes, well, thank you very much.
Well, I didn't. Well, thanks for the question. You know, I have been a part owner of the Chicago Sky since it started.
Yes, sir.
And so I really believe in women's professional basketball.
Yes.
Basketball. Mm-hmm. This year we had three dynamic players make the All-Star team.
Yes, sir.
And we think that there's a chance that in the next couple of years we can be world champions. We've got a great local Chicago franchise with some, again, dynamic women players who are going to do really, really, really well.
Yes.
It's funny that I had this opportunity now, because when I was playing basketball at Princeton, my old coach, Pete Carrillo, used to always give me a hard time because I was always spending too much time hanging out with the women players back in college.
Yes, sir.
And so now it's kind of ironic that I'm back involved with the women players, but it's just been fun. I also, excuse me, this last year I got elected to the board of directors of Nike Corporation.
Okay.
So for someone who loves basketball, it's just been this magical experience to be associated with that great brand.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
There's a really good board. Tim Cook is the lead director. The CEO of Apple is the lead director at Nike. Phil Knight, the founder of Nike, is still on the board, along with John Thompson, who is the famous Georgetown coach who won the national championship.
Yes,
he's a terrific person to have on the board when it's a great company like Nike.
Yes,
so I've been really privileged to do that. And it's kind of one nice irony, you know, I had people, a lot of people have seen the chance, saw me play Michael Jordan one-on-one on YouTube.
Yes, sir.
And Michael made fun of me on the YouTube video because I was wearing Adidas.
Mm-hmm.
And so now I've ditched all of my Adidas and I'm a full-time Nike lover.
Nike lover. And, you know, I do want to kind of echo Brother Emmanuel. And he's serious, because they go to the games, they post it on social media. Everyone loves their experience watching the Sky down at Wintrust. And the WNBA has really taken off. You're seeing a lot of growth. I know in the recent All-Star game, it was even an undrafted player who was the MVP.
Right.
And, you know, it's very good to have a product that's accessible, that's good, and it's growing. And so I commend you on that, because I know a lot more people are starting to go down there and take notice of the Sky's success.
Well, that's great to hear. It's been fun. I was actually in Las Vegas for the All-Star game and got to hang out, and, you know, it was just couldn't have been more of a fun weekend. And we have a new commissioner.
Yeah.
And so you're right. The energy is building and
yes.
The brand is getting built.
That is wonderful. Well, we knew that we only had you here for 30 minutes. You know, these shows go by so quick. We could talk to you all day, but you have to promise to come back again and make sure that you sit with us. Will you come back again?
For sure.
Well, I thank you. Brothers and sisters, we're going to take a short break and come back with another guest on the other side. Brother John Rogers of Ariel Investments have been our guest, and thank you so very much.
You're welcome.
We'll be right back after the break.
The Munir Muhammad Show is brought to you by ComEd. For tips on managing your energy bill and helping the environment, call 1-800-EDISON-1 or visit comedcare.com.
ComEd Smart Ideas presents The Power of Energy Efficiency. Altogether, you have saved over $700 million, all because you took part in our energy efficiency programs. like our central AC rebates, fridge and freezer recycling, and lighting discounts. The small changes you've made to be more energy efficient really add up. The math is easy. ComEd's energy efficiency programs equal savings for you. Learn more about energy efficiency at ComEd.com/home savings. ComEd, powering lives.
People in the city don't really know about the forest preserves. They're kind of a wonderful green emerald ring around the city. The forest preserves are owned by the taxpayers, and it's about 69,000 acres, 11% of our land. It's a wonderful, wonderful asset. You're out here, you can hear the wind in the trees, you can hear the birds. So it's very, very peaceful.
This is one of the oldest forest preserve district in the United States, and the largest forest preserve district in the United States. Drive in and set up a picnic, unload your bike, go for a swim at one of our aquatic centers, or bring out your fishing pole. All of these things are accessible to everybody for free 365 days a year. Beyond just active recreation is the conservation side of the preserve and the aspect of land management. We're the last bastion in many cases for certain plants and animals that really are only found here in the forest preserves of Cook County.
Zoonotic disease represents the fastest growing infectious disease in the world today. And about 75% of the new diseases are zoonotic, those that are transmitted from animals to humans.
Taking the seeds of a flower, and then you pack it all into some soil and some flour, and you take it home, and you can throw it out into a vacant lot or a garden, your front yard, and just give it time to grow, and it blooms into one of these flowers here.
I see myself working with the forest preserves. It's just so great to see children excited about being outdoors, and so that they can learn from a young age, because the future of our earth is with the children.
Have this kind of open space so close to a major metropolis is really unheard of. The more people are connected and have an appreciation for it, the more people will want to protect it and even enhance it and even grow it. A lot of people have lost some of their roots of being outdoors. This is something that's a treasure that we need to protect in the long term, and that it is of value to them.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to the Munir Muhammad Show. Again, I'm your host, Brother Jamil Muhammad. This is a live call-in show. You can participate by calling us at 773-434-6625. And in this segment, joining me is Brother Ishmael Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
Brother, how are you today?
Doing great. About yourself?
I'm doing well, brother. Thank you for asking. Thank you for joining. You saw Mr. John Rogers, our earlier guest, as he was talking about really the financial divide. He gave a lot of good information. You can see how engaged he's in the community. He's a tremendous advocate and works in so many venues, and which is always inspiring. But it really took me back to the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad's teachings, and that's the teaching of pooling the resources. One of the things he talked about is that even though the diverse spend, the data says one thing, but the impact in our community, what it feels like as far as our dollars going farther, it's not there. And the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, especially here in Chicago, just as a example, we had schools, we had restaurants, we had the bank, we had the printing press, all of these things by black people. Not only the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he gave reference to Mr. Johnson, but we had a viable black network of businesses. And so one of the things that Mr. Rogers alluded to is that the black businesses, now we know that the Nation of Islam, of course, Wallace Muhammad tied everything up in probate court, and that's how we lost many of the things there. But as far as supporting black business, what do you think are some of the biggest gaps in our community to keep us, I'm not going to say from supporting it, but supporting black business after we might have had an unpleasant experience? And I want to put that caveat out there because I know that we can go talk about buying black, but usually when something happens or we don't have the best experience, if something happens, we begin to shy away or we won't go back, but we don't have that same type of energy for other communities and other businesses. And so what is it that you think always keeps us from being committed to our own black community?
You know, that's a really good question because I've make it my business to actually go and patriot, you know, spend my money at black businesses.
Yes.
And I do that every week. Mm-hmm. So I select a couple of different businesses and I make sure I go and I spend some money at those businesses. And for me, it makes me feel great to know that I'm putting money back into my community, back into the pockets of my own people so they can grow their business and be successful and we can keep the economic engine going. Mm-hmm. But as far as like us as consumers and how we are so hard on ourselves, and we are so easy to forgive others that maybe if we have a little bit of inconsistency in our product or in our service, though we're let's say we're new to this, you know, we're not as our systems are maybe not as sharp as others. So we're coming in, we're doing our best, like as black businesses, and I think we should be more forgiving and more lenient as we are to other people. But I think it just kind of goes back to that self-hatred and the envy and that type of spirit that we have within ourselves. And I think we should just learn to love each other a little bit more and give each other a little bit more a break, you know, because when we're doing something, and the more we spend money at black businesses, the better our community is going to get. And I have no problem seeing another black person become more wealthy than me, become in a position where they can open more facilities, open more stores, and hire more people. Yeah. Because we just sat here on the couch listening to Mr. Rogers telling us about how, you know, we got to force these other companies to give us opportunities. Right. We got to force them and hold them accountable and try to twist their arms to do something for us. Mm-hmm. Well, if the sandwich didn't come out right this time, okay, let them know, hey, you know, maybe next time try this, and I'll come back tomorrow and see if you got it right that time, and I'll keep my money again. So I don't have to force someone to twist somebody's arm. I can go right to my brother and say, you know what, you're a successful person, this, that, and the other. How did you do it? How can I start my business? How can I do this? Can I partner with you? Yeah. You know, can I open a franchise? Yeah. So I think that when we start to think on that level, and of course, you and I being trained up by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, we have that unconditional love for our people. Mm-hmm. Though we may get frustrated with our people for the things that they do, but we understand at the end of the day, we know where we come from, we know where we're working with.
I think that we judge one another with such a critical eye.
Mm-hmm.
Because even as a customer, we do things with black business, everything is a negotiation. Mm-hmm. Can you give me a deal on this? Or can you do that? And we go into other establishments. If it doesn't say sale, we don't ask for one, we just go ahead and do things. And so what I'm saying is that we are more critical with each other. So I'm not going to sit here and say that the customer service is worse. It's that we take things more personally sometimes when it happens in the course of dealing with one another than someone else. And you're right, it goes back to that self-hatred. And the thing as far as pride as well, because when the brother was talking about even as businesses start to decline, instead of pooling our resources so that we both could stay viable, we will function as individuals until both of us just fall to the wayside. I mean, and I know that, for example, the newspaper, the black newspapers, and I know that print news isn't what it used to be, but we shouldn't have so many black newspapers falling by the wayside that would hope that we could at least pool some of our resources to at least combine and do something together to at least maintain some viability. And that is the part that's a little bit disappointing, is that we would rather suffer and go out of business than either humbling ourselves or collaborating with a like business and see if we could do something together.
You know, this kind of reminds me of a guy was telling me a story about how one brother had a restaurant and the other brother had a grocery store. Mm-hmm. And what happened was these were not black people, but you know, mm-hmm. when the restaurant needed fish or meat or something like that, he'll go down the street to his brother, mm-hmm. to the grocery store. He'll have a little line of credit with him. Yeah. You know, he'd bring the food back. He'd make sure that his guests are serving everything like that. So they two are working together. Then after he make the money, he go pay off what he had to pay his brother, mm-hmm. and they keep that going. Mm-hmm. And then so with that type of economic thinking, they can buy up that whole block. They can open up more establishment, more mm-hmm. stores, open up more restaurants, mm-hmm. Just because they're working together, like one hand washes the other, you yes. know. And then you have maybe a cousin that may have a transport company. Okay, now he can go pick up different things for the grocery store, pick up different things for the restaurant. But that's how we have to work together, yeah. you know. So and if we are continuing to, and this is another thing that I notice a lot is with black people, is like we wait until we are all the way down to the floor before we say, I need some help. Because yeah. we have this sense of pride that, you know, they probably think I'm not going to make it, or I got to prove, I got to show something. Mm-hmm. Like when white people are in trouble, when their credit score is above 750, that's when they file bankruptcy. Mm-hmm. Before they even have a late payment, mm-hmm. that's when they file bankruptcy. And then they wipe out all that debt mm-hmm. that they didn't have to worry about no more. Then they come right back with a 720 credit score, start right over again, pick up right where they left off. Well, but us, we have to wait until we all the way down on the floor before we can actually say, I need some help.
And by design, it's a system designed for them so they know how to take advantage of it.
Yeah.
And by the time we learn those things or are confident to at least utilize them, sometimes the rules change. But, you know, to your earlier point about the continuity of doing things and growing incrementally, one of the beautiful things about the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad is that he taught us not to live beyond our means. He taught us to pool our resources and, you know, and before buying fine cars or fancy things, make sure that you have a place to live. He taught us how to be responsible with our money and how to grow that way. And so I think as a community, if we began to look at that program, look at the program of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and modeling that, we can begin to again establish black business. Now, I know that there's a conscious movement right now, and you're right, and it's intentional to go and spend money with black businesses. And we are seeing a rise on that, particularly here in Chicago, and I'm sure throughout the nation. But we want to begin to sustain that and do bigger things, because as our previous guests talked about, we do a lot of successful, incremental successes on a small scale. But how do we begin to pool those resources and maybe get a black supermarket chain? Or how do we begin to do things to pool our resources to think at that next level to supply something to an entire community instead of a 2-3 block radius and things like that? So everything ties back to the messenger, because it was such a life-giving teachings, and we see that the things that we're suffering from now in our community, that he still has the answer, because he was always right and exact. Again, brothers and sisters, this is a live call-in show. You can join us at 773-434-7255. 6625. I'm joined here by Brother Ishmael Muhammad, and we're really talking about the financial blueprint and the message of the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad and how to pool our resources and support black business. Now, Brother, you talked about you make it a habit weekly to spend money with black businesses. So I'm sure that may not be the most convenient every time, but what I'm sure that the business owners appreciate you. So what is that experience like for you in being able to buy black?
You know, first of all, it makes me feel great mm-hmm. that not only that I'm helping my own people out, and also see every time I go back to that establishment, they got more business coming in, they got more customers coming in, they're keeping their businesses going. Mm-hmm. Like that makes me feel great because I understand the importance of that and having businesses in your community. Right. That's the heartbeat of the community.
Right.
So that's how you keep your community alive. That's how you keep it from having abandoned, boarded up buildings and tore down houses and you know, youth that don't have jobs and things to do. Like that's what we have to do. So yeah, I may pass 100 establishments that are not black or that may have better service or a better product to go to one other product, to go to this one store
right.
to make sure that I put a couple of dollars in their pocket because I know throughout the rest of the week I'm buying gas here, I'm doing this, that, and the other, mm-hmm. and my money's going all out of my community. Right. But other communities, they make sure they circulate their dollars. Mm-hmm. And that's what I want to do. I want to start circulating those dollars. Mm-hmm. And you know, to go back to the messenger, you know, he was an investor too, and his stock was the untapped potential of black people. Mm-hmm. And what he built was such a great example, and I just wish that more people would just take a look at him mm-hmm. and just kind of analyze what he did, because I think when people think of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, they think, you know, Nation of Islam, this, that, and the other, but maybe he's just for them. But the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was for all black people. Mm-hmm. And what he built with the nation was an example for all of us and also a benefit for all of us, mm-hmm. not just those who believe, but also those who didn't believe, as he gave jobs to and supported businesses and people that were not in the Nation of Islam. Mm-hmm. So what he did for us, he unlocked our minds to let us know and make us to think, you know what, we have to do this for ourselves. We have right. to do this for each other. Like, we can't always wait for someone else. We can't always rely on trying to force someone else to do something for us. Like, we have right. to do this for ourselves.
Right.
And that's one of the things that really made me to fall in love with him, because right. he really just loved his people.
Right.
You know, it didn't matter if you made Salat or anything like that, or right. if you say all praise due to Allah. Yeah. As long as you say, you know what, I'm black and I love myself and I want to do something for my people. And that's the type of thing that he built. Now, yeah, we had trucking, we had newspaper, we had banking, we had the schools, we had the bakeries and restaurants.
So a lot of things. So it was indeed a nation within a nation. And brothers and sisters, now, well, you know what? This is what I want to do. We are going to take a quick break, because by you saying that, I think we have a veteran out there who was around in that day, and I want to give them the opportunity to close out this show by bearing witness at first hand what the Messages program looked like and to be a part of it. So, brothers and sisters, this is a live show, but we'll be right back. Don't touch that dial.
This portion of the Munir Muhammad Show is brought to you by Ariel Mutual Funds, where slow and steady wins the race.
Searching for a restaurant that serves delicious home-cooked meals at an affordable price like your grandmother used to make? Well, the search is over. Stop by MacArthur's, the new talk of Chicago. We offer a warm atmosphere with friendly service and excellent meals, ranging from carryout, dine-in, or catering for your special events. MacArthur's is open 7 days per week from 11 a.m. until 9 p.m. Come visit us at
5412
West Madison Street or call us at 773-261-2316.
Everything I hope for.
This portion of the Munir Muhammad Show is brought to you by East Lake Management, innovative solutions for building communities of the future today.
The Munir Muhammad Show is brought to you by ComEd. For tips on managing your energy bill and helping the environment, call 1-800-EDISON-1 or visit comedcare.com.
Assalamu alaikum, and again, welcome back. I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. This is the Munir Muhammad Show, and we couldn't complete this show without having our beautiful and wonderful co-founders on the show. Brothers, we were just talking about a nation within a nation, what the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad created, and I was here with Brother Ishmael, and we were bearing witness to what we knew historically and got a taste of, but you all were there, and I just wanted you to help us close out this show by telling about the pride and joy that you had of having all those beautiful black Muslim businesses created by the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
It was a thing of pride, to say the very least. Just going to the grocery store was like really going to the temple, because everybody in there was black and one of us. Of course, there were sympathizers who made purchases at the grocery store and all of the other venues, but it just was such a dignified thing to be doing something with your own. And I didn't have a lot of money in the bank, but I relished at the opportunity to go put two more dollars in or something like that. You never knew who you... I first saw Muhammad Ali in person at the bank, and it just... we need to do it again.
Yes, sir.
That's what we stand for. Let's see if we can do that again.
Yes, sir. What about you, Brother Shaheed?
Well, Brother C, we had farmland. We had tractor. In fact, we had four tractor trailers, and these tractor trailers delivered our papers to the East Coast, up there in Philadelphia, and we had the Southern run, and sometimes we would go all the way out to L.A., but usually I would ship the papers out to L.A. to Los Angeles, and they would, and normally they would go by TWA, because I used to deal with the airlines by me being the circulation manager, and I found out they have something called 310 containers. Now you could put all you could in that container for one price, no matter what the weight was. So what I would do, all the brothers that live close to Los Angeles, I would put all their papers in this container and let the brothers know they had to go to the airport to pick their papers up. Same thing by San Francisco. They had to go to San Francisco to pick their papers up. And that's what I would do. Put them in them 10-3 containers. And like I said, we had farmland, but Brother Albert, who was the he was the guy that sent the trucks out.
Right, dispatcher.
And we would load the papers up on the truck, and the truck would take them to, you know, to where they wanted to go. Everything.
That's why I wanted you all here to give a first-hand account and bear witness. See, we talked about it, but you all were there, and so I know it was short. We're gonna have to have you all on again, brothers. But thank you for making an appearance, because it's always beautiful to see your faces.
Thank you,
brothers and sisters in our viewing audience. Again, just recapping. Our wonderful guests, like to thank Mr. John Rogers from Aerial Capital. We also have a lot of financial information. He's such an advocate for things in the community, what he was doing for our students in particular, teaching financial literacy. We had our brother Ishmael Muhammad, who we've come to love and appreciate, bearing witness. And then finally closing out with my brothers and co-founders, brother Shaheed Muslim and Khalif Muhammad. And as always, great to see your smiling faces when we could all have the opportunity to talk about the most honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Sir. Yes, sir, brother. Okay.
Well, for those of you in our viewing audience, thank you for viewing. We leave you in the nation's greetings of peace and paradise. Of assalamu alaikum.